This week on Maker Update, games that are fast, games that are small, hats that are tall, kids on the lawn, and bagels that surf. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, back with another Maker Update, this time from outside. I thought I'd show you a little bit of Barcelona's Festa Major de Gràcia. I've got a link down in the description where you can learn more about that, and I've got another great show for you, so let's get started with the project of the week. On the Playful Technology channel, Alistair Atchison offers up an in-depth look at how we created this one-button escape room game called Orbital. It's a take on the 1D reaction game Cyclone. As the light moves around the ring, you need to time your button press right when it passes over the green dot. When you level up, you move to the next ring, you beat all three rings, and you get a little light show, and a magnetic latch is unlocked for your next escape room clue. The design uses an arcade button, addressable LED rings, an Arduino, and a relay module, so it's a relatively low-cost, low-complexity build, but what you get is so fun and interesting and can be adapted in a bunch of different ways. Because it all comes down to a single Arduino routine, you could easily increase the number of LEDs, or the number of rings, or the length of the trail. You could speed it up, change the colors, or limit the number of attempts you get for each ring. Instead of activating a relay at the end, you could add an LED score, or maybe loop back through the levels at a faster speed. There's just so much room to play with here. But if making those kinds of adjustments sounds like a daunting task of hacking the code until it breaks, that's where Alistair's guide really goes above and beyond. He spends over 25 minutes going over the code, explaining each function line by line. He points out all the little places where adjustments can be made and why you might want to. It's a level of explanation that's so valuable, but you rarely see it because, honestly, how many of us really have a top-to-bottom understanding of what our Arduino sketch is doing? It's a rarity for me, so this level of insight is just incredibly useful, especially if I'm going to muster the courage to modify what he's done. Alistair has made the code available to his Patreon supporters. You can find a link in his video description. Now for some news. The Tiny Games Challenge is underway, presented by Hackaday and DigiKey. And honestly, Alistair's game would make a pretty good entry. The idea is to submit your own electronics-based game that's both fun and minimal, whether that's a tiny size, tiny parts count, or tiny code. The top three entrants will receive a $150 gift certificate courtesy of DigiKey. You can find out all the details using the link in the description. Now for more projects. On Adafruit, Erin St. Blaine has a guide on how she made this sound-reactive LED top hat. Erin really goes the extra mile on this one. Not only does she demonstrate how to make use of the audio-reactive version of the WLED software, but she also shows how you can use a single button to switch through different modes, including an LED matrix setup for mapped animations. It's really thoughtfully done. This week, I also learned about the alt-control indie game called Get Off My Lawn, developed by a 10-person team who I've listed in the description. The game concept is that you're a grumpy old man spraying children off your lawn with a garden hose. But the controller is what really gets my attention here. The rocking chair is augmented with an accelerometer to detect rocking, which you have to do to keep your character awake. There's also an RFID sensor in the cup holder, where you occasionally need to swap out your cup for extra power. And then there's the garden hose controller, which is a 3D printed housing for an infrared position camera that tracks the movement, along with a switch for turning the spray on and off. Not a lot of technical details on this one, but I just love when I see an application for electronics and sensors like this that I haven't seen before. Looks like a fun game too. Speaking of things I've never seen before, check out this bagel-themed Tide Clock from Rabbit Creek. Talk about your conversation piece, and the conversation goes a little something like this. There's a region of Alaska where Rabbit Creek lives where surf-worthy waves occasionally come through an otherwise calm inlet of water. These brief waves are caused by the incoming edge of a phenomenon called a bore tide. And for the locals, one of the best predictors of the waves is a guy in a weird van, often found in a parking lot near the water. It also happens to be next to one of the area's best bagel shops. So, knowing all that, Could you really think of a better way to indicate if it's a good time to pack up your board and head into town for a bagel and some surfing? As far as the components go, the bagel, thumb, and electronics enclosure are all 3D printed and the files are included in the instructable. Inside, there's an ESP32 microcontroller, a real-time clock, some addressable LEDs that go around the side, and a high-torque servo to turn the thumb. The included code is an Arduino file that calculates existing tied table data and matches it up with the real-time clock. So even though it can be connected to the internet, it should be able to make accurate offline predictions for the next 10 years. Such a fun and oddly specific, oddly practical project. I just love the idea of making something so completely personalized for your area and lifestyle. Now for some tips and tools. On YouTube, Pekero shares a concept for a 38-segment display. The goal here is to create a new type of segmented display capable of displaying unmodified Chinese and Japanese numerals, as well as some limited katakana and kanji characters. As Pekero points out, at 38 segments, you may as well commit to using a matrix display, but it's a fun challenge to work out, and it's a cool look for a Blade Runner-y vacuum fluorescent display concept. You can find a link to an SVG of the design in the description. On the Hackaday blog, Arya Voronova has a useful rundown of the options you have for running audio out of your Raspberry Pi. The guide covers USB audio, Bluetooth, network audio, HDMI audio, I2S, and PWM. The short answer, though, is that USB audio is a simple, cheap solution that should cover you in most situations, but don't let that stop you from looking at the other options, especially if you need a wireless solution. Finally, an interesting tip from Adrian Perez on how he made a section of silicone robot skin that can register pressure or touch. The solution here is a sandwich of silicone and magnetic tape placed over a Hall effect sensor. As you apply pressure, the Hall effect sensor registers the movement of the magnetic tape, which you can interpret in your code. Getting to this solution took a lot of trial and error in an attempt to make a kind of magnetic silicone using iron filings. It's a logical idea he just couldn't get to work, but coming around to magnetic tape makes for a much simpler solution that anyone can tinker with. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, check out the latest episode of Potentially Genius. This time, the team from Tomorrow Lab are asked to come up with a unique project for Spark Fund's XRP Robotics Kit. You get to see the team go from brainstorming to prototyping, problem solving, and finally arriving at this design for an automatic domino placing machine. Be sure to check it out. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Let me know what project or tip really stood out for you this week. And big thanks to DigiKey, as always, for making this show possible. And thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.